Men and women and brains and some other stuff. Sounded like a zombie horror flick at this point, so it sounds kind of fun. So here's Laura.
My piece of relationship advice is if you're going to marry someone who gives you a really good introduction when you have to talk to a room full of people. So I don't repeat myself, because I have spoken at SASH every year. How many of you are new to SASH this year? Awesome. Welcome, guys. How many of you were here last year? This is not a loaded question. How many of you remember what I talked about last year?
Okay, not y'all.
You're my favorites. Okay. No. Today we're going to talk about masculinity, femininity, and the differences between men and women. But in order to get us started, we have to sort of come to four basic understandings first. So that's what we're going to do. And this year I've upped my game a little bit, and I'm not destroying a bouquet of flowers.
Ooh,
that was last
then.
Year. But I did bring visual aids. So understanding number one is that there are absolute truths. There just are. If I have this glass of water, and I look at this glass of water and I say, I feel like if I dump this water out, I want it to go in my mouth. I mean, that's how I'm feeling. I'm feeling really thirsty. That didn't work, did it? In that case, my feelings were not in line with reality, were they? What if I say, my truth is that gravity is a social construct that was imposed on us by cisgendered colonialists, so I don't believe in it. That's my truth, okay? Well, that didn't work either. Because the reality is, gravity exists. Whether or not I feel like it, whether or not I've accepted it, that is a truth. Some truths are absolute. This is how the natural world is governed, okay? There are laws that govern the created order of the world, of the universe, gravity being one of them. Much like civil laws, whether or not I choose to accept them is going to have consequences. I could go down to Lowe's and I could steal a lawnmower and drive it down 81 because I've decided that that lawnmower it's just as good as a car. I am going to be stopped by Frederick County's finest and probably hauled off to see their beautiful institution. So if I break this civil law, there are obvious consequences. Same thing with natural law. The same thing with the natural order. This is where my friend Mo the Mad Cow comes in. If you've heard me talk before, you have heard me talk about mad cow disease, but we're going to talk about it again because it's my favorite example of natural law and what happens when we violate it. Way back in the 90s, I was alive then, my children actually graciously, when they were little, came to the realization that, Mom, you were born in the 1900s. That made me feel really old. But back in the 90s, it was discovered in the United Kingdom that cows were becoming homicidal, cannibalistic maniacs who would attack each other. And if they didn't kill each other, they would eventually kill themselves or they would die. This became known as mad cow disease. It was later discovered that the feed these cows were fed included ground up cow. That's nasty. Okay, cows are meant to be herbivores. They're supposed to eat grass and not other cows. That's how they were created. That, you could say, is one of the natural laws that governs the bovine herd. They're not cannibals. Yet, when that law of their nature was violated, when these cows were cannibalized, They went crazy. See, that took me a minute too. Mad cow doesn't mean angry cow. It was the United Kingdom. It meant crazy cow. It took me about 2 years to figure that out, so I point that out now. So I like that example because it's a little bit dramatic, but it's spot on for an example of what happens when we take the natural order, when we take a natural law and we violate it. There are always consequences. Consequences that are harmful, usually to ourselves, usually to other people. So that's our first basic understanding. There are absolute truths, and there are laws that govern the created order. Here's the second understanding. It is that some realities are intrinsic, meaning they are internal. They are interiorly known. Some realities are extrinsic. They are external. They are exteriorly known. These words we're going to come back to. Okay, so our first basic understanding, right? Absolute truths. Second basic understanding, there are interior, intrinsic, and exterior, extrinsic realities. Third understanding. Everything has an essence of being, or we could say a nature. Let's take this bowl. The nature of this bowl is that it is a bowl. It has bowlness, right? I can look at it and I can say I would like it to be a coffee mug. It is never going to be a coffee mug. It's always going to be a bowl. If I break the bowl, well, did it turn into a coffee mug? No. Did it turn into a puppy?
That'd be nice.
It's still a bowl, but now it's a broken bowl. The fact that I destroyed it didn't change its nature. It didn't change what it is. It's still a bowl. Now it's just broken. Similarly, everything has this essence of being, its ness, right? I love cats. My husband has probably complained about that to you because we have six, because they kept having cats. And then more cats. And now we're hoping we're not having more cats. See me in a month, you might get free kittens. But let's pretend this is my cat, okay? This cat doesn't wake up in the morning and affirm its catness. The cat does not wake up in the morning and say, I feel like a cat today. No, the cat just wakes up and goes about being a cat. Even when my cat starts to behave like a dog, and sometimes he does, mm-hmm. or more like a possum, while he stretches himself across the driveway and we think he's dead, he's still a cat. His behavior doesn't change what he is. His behavior isn't changing his essence of being or his nature. Still a cat. This is his intrinsic reality. He is a cat. He always will be a cat. Now, let's say, for the sake of argument, my cat all of a sudden is gifted free will, some form of reason and speech. And my cat says to me, I want to be a sloth. Make me a sloth. I mean, honestly, for a cat, that's like the only thing you can upgrade to, right? So here's this cat, wants to be a sloth. Well, I could get him species reassignment surgery. I could attach long fingernails right to his feet. I could alter his appearance on the outside, that external thing that we have going on. But guess what? He is still going to be a cat because that is his nature. That is his essence of being. Okay, so externally he looks like a sloth. Internally, intrinsically, still a cat. So that's our third understanding. There is a nature and an essence of being to created things, to ourselves. masculinity and femininity are intrinsic, absolute realities. They are governed by the laws of nature. They are proven by science. They have biological realities that are attached to them. They are ordered and established by God. We cannot change them. They aren't fluid. Masculinity and femininity aren't feelings. They are not defined by external values, even though they can be understood sometimes in terms of function, even though they imply biological reality. You are masculine and feminine in your very nature, in your very being. Woven throughout your entire being is this masculinity and femininity. It's your isness as men and women. See, and that's so part of who you are and how you are created, that this reality exists to the point where you could, through your own free will, attempt to defy your biological nature. You could mutilate, you could medicate, you could ignore the external realities. You could even interrupt healthy biological functions. But you will never be able to change who you are created as, men and women. That's kind of a big deal. And you know what? The intrinsic nature of who you are as men and women, and what that means, it's under attack. And it's confusing now. Because we're given these lies that somehow gender and sex and biology are all independent of each other. That some are self-assigned or self-determined. They're not. That somehow these external forces are what are going to define you as men and women. But the reality is, you are either male or female. And you have a right to be told that when you try to ignore who you are as men and women, when you try to alter who you are as men and women in your very being, when you decide, you know what, I feel like I want to be other than I am, and you decide to go against that natural order, that natural law that God gave us, there are going to be consequences. And just like Mo the mad cow, they're going to hurt us. And you have a right to be told that too. You have a right to be told that the way God created you as men and as women has a purpose. That the way God created you as men and as women is the way He made you to encounter the world. And not only that, it's how He made you to exist in this world. And in doing so, you have something to show the rest of us. Who you are as men and women is God's gift to the whole world. You see, because when He created men and women, right? We hear that over and over again. Back in Genesis, God created the male and female. He created them. Well, we hear it over and over again because it's important. But why? Well, because God loves to reveal Himself in His creation. He knows we've got thick heads. He knows because He made them thick, right? He created us. Then we screwed it up in the Garden of Eden and made them even thicker. Then we get sin in the picture. We get this concupiscence thing going on. All of a sudden, we're really confused. So God takes every opportunity He can to teach us something about Himself. What is He teaching us about Himself through masculinity and femininity? Because He is. That could be a whole separate talk. But the point is, as men, as women, the way you live who you are not only helps you encounter God, it teaches everyone else you come in contact with something about God, too. And that's kind of cool. Who you are, how you're created, teaches the world something about the awesomeness of God. That's beautiful. That's something you deserve to be told. Now this truth, this way of encountering the world, is different for men and for women. Now if you've spent any time around men and around women, this kind of sounds like a no-brainer. Except once again, we're kind of fed these lies that somehow who we are as men and women has to be equitable. That's the new word, not equal anymore. We are equal. We're all equal in dignity, not necessarily equal in what we can do. Equity tends to take things a step further, saying we have to level the playing field. There can't be differences. That doesn't make sense. So what I'd like to talk about are some of those differences and how they're good, and how they can apply to the relationships that we have in our lives, and how they might apply to relationships later on if you're called to marriage. Now, here's a spoiler. I'm going to share a little bit about my husband, and I'm going to pretend he's not here listening. Because guess what? We're different. And yet, we're married for almost 18 years now, and we've learned how to live with each other and learned how to live with these differences, because they're good. But it would have been super helpful, I think, earlier on if someone had told us about them. It would have saved us probably some awkwardness, probably some misunderstandings, probably me overreacting. Often. One of the biological differences between men and women has to do with our brains. There is a part of the brain called the corpus callosum. It's a white matter information bridge. In women, the corpus callosum is more developed than it is in men. This does not mean that men are brain dead. Well, most of them. No, it simply means our brains transmit information differently. Now, fueling some of this info transmission are also hormones. Not surprisingly, women tend to be a beautiful cocktail of a complicated bouquet, if you will, of hormones. And those hormones tend to do this all the time. Now, men have their own hormonal cocktail as well. But men tend to have one primary hormone that does a lot more than the rest of them, okay? Women tend to have at least three at any given time, all vying for attention. This helps some of that information transmission, okay? Women's hormones kind of fuel everything going on in the brain in a different way than men's hormones do. But back to that info bridge. So picture this white matter, right? Sort of like this vast chasm. And there's these little information pings that need to get from one side to the other. So the brain yeets them across this info bridge, and that's how information gets shared. Now, in women, because this bridge is more developed, let's say it has more lanes in it, like a big highway, women's brains tend to be sharing information constantly. It's why I can tell you the night that he proposed to me, I ate spaghetti for dinner, I had half a glass of wine to drink, and then a big thing of water to drink. I was wearing a black skirt and a red sparkly shirt. I had on my sparkly gold shoes. We went to mass, started 5 minutes late. I could tell you exactly what he said when he proposed, how he got down on one knee, kind of, but it took him like two tries, how someone was in the corner sneezing, and he was waiting for them to leave, and it got awkward for a second, and how he will be able to tell you, she said yes. Now, it doesn't mean that night didn't mean as much to him as it did to me. It means our brains did exactly what they were supposed to do in that moment. It's why I can be simultaneously on the phone, cooking dinner, sort of half homeschooling one of the kids, and maybe putting the phone call on hold and answering another one while I'm remembering that there's laundry going. And when he walks in the door, it's, I'm gonna sit down, I'm going to look around, I'm gonna eat my dinner. Right? Women multitask. Again, because that's how our brains are wired. Men tend to not be able to multitask as well. Why? Because your brains are not wired for it. That's a difference. It's good. It's how it's supposed to be. But yet, not understanding those differences, wouldn't it be so easy for me, as you know, I'm like stirring spaghetti sauce with my foot and switching laundry with another hand and teaching the children how to speak Latin all at the same time, right? And he walks in and sits down, collects himself for a moment, and then goes, oh good, it's time to eat, right? I could get really angry about that. I could be like, do you see me stirring the spaghetti with my foot? Right? But understanding this is how we're made, well, number one, that prevents us from an argument. It prevents our feelings from getting hurt. But it also allows me to understand when Chris has to prepare for Sash, and he is honed in, planning out the year, he's able to take that ability to not multitask, laser focus on something, and come up with an amazing program. Men, you have a strength in your ability to not multitask. You have a strength in your ability to be able to focus on something and block out everything else and concentrate. It's a lot harder for women to do that. It's a good thing, because somebody has to be keeping the children alive, if there are children, right? That tends to be the woman, because we can multitask. See, we're different. It's our brains. We can't even consciously help it sometimes. Sort of along those lines, along that ability to laser focus, we've come up with a term that we in our family call mammothing. Way back, she's gonna laugh, way back, right, in our ancestors' days where they're in the cave, women tended to be the gatherers, right? They've got the little cave babies in tow. They have to go out and gather kindling to keep the fire going, berries to feed them, maybe some nuts, maybe some herbs. Gathering, right? We're focusing on all the things. Look at that brain at work, sharing information. Gather, gather, gather. Kids are still alive. They didn't get eaten by a saber tooth. Awesome. Gather, gather, gather. The men, right, were hunters. They had to go out. They had to be able to laser focus on that mammoth, so they could hunt it, so they could feed their family. Or they had to be able to laser focus on that threat that was going to attack their family so they could protect them, right? That's why we call it mammothing. Mammoth, kill, eat, good. Well, nowadays, we don't tend to have to go out and forage for food or firewood. We still have to keep food alive. Sorry, boys, but you've met my boys. You know that at some point that was probably really difficult, right? Men don't have to go hunt unless they want to. So how does this play out now? Well, the first year we were married, we're living in Maryland. We had a weekend, and I'm like, I'm kind of bored. I think I want to go shopping. But I was like, I can't just tell him I want to go shopping. I should come up with a reason for us to go shopping. So I'm like, we need a shower curtain. So, honey, we need a shower curtain. Can we go to the mall? Let's go to the mall. I'm already thinking like window shopping, food court, yay. But you know, shower curtain. So he's, oh yeah, sure. You need a shower curtain? Great. So we drive to the mall. I'm getting excited because right now we're gonna have like a date and we're out shopping together. He's thinking, we need a shower curtain. So we park by Sears or whatever the department store was. We go in. I'm already off gathering. I'm like, oh, pillows. Oh, throw blankets. Oh, look at these hand towels, right? I don't know where he is. He disappeared. No joke, 5 minutes later, he comes back with a white shower curtain. Got it, let's go. But the food court, you know. There is an example, and that's why we started calling it mammothing. I will admit, I didn't quite handle the follow-up to that experience very well. I got slightly passive-aggressive and didn't talk to him for the whole ride home because he ruined our date that he didn't know we were on. Then we talked it out and we realized that he was mammothing and I was gathering, and now we communicate about that a little bit better. Like I say, let's go on a date. And he says, okay, this is a date. And then we don't go by shower curtains, we actually go on a date. So there we have it again, right? Our brains at work, the differences in how we're made at work. Here is one that in friendships, in relationships, and in families, kind of makes you wonder what God was thinking when he did it this way. It's how men and women respond to stress and how they tend to lower stress in themselves. So here we go back to hormones. Cortisol is the stress hormone. And it builds up in our brains the more stressed out we get. In women, when we get this cortisol buildup, we tend to need to talk it out. Sometimes we isolate first, sometimes we have to sort through it, but at some point, we've got to get it out. Better out than in, that's what they say in Shrek, right? So we have to talk. We have to get the words out. Men, however, when men are stressed, the more cortisol they have built up in their brains, the more they need to power down. Shut the brain off, power down. That helps to lower the cortisol. Sometimes it includes doing something mindless, scrolling on the phone, flipping channels on a TV, staring at a wall. Guess what tends to increase cortisol in men when they're already stressed? Talking. Guess what's really difficult to figure out when you're in a friendship or a relationship and both of you are stressed, and one of you is a man and one of you is a woman? Whoa. You've got the woman who needs to talk, the man who really doesn't, and you have a potential for a lot of conflict there. The potential for a lot of hurt feelings. Knowing these things, knowing that for men, cortisol level has to come down with kind of like a brain power down. And knowing that for women, at some point, we've got to get the words out to get the stress out. That allows you to communicate so you can meet each other's needs. And this is what friendship is about, right? Wanting what's best for the other person. In marriage, it allows us to say things like, hey, so I'm super stressed right now and I'm going to need to talk at you, but can you let me know when I can do that? Or if we're going through something super stressful together, it's, I know you might need to just kind of brain melt, go quiet, but when you're ready, I need to talk. Or conversely, there are times where I know, hey, Chris is stressed. I know he just would really love to take a minute, shut down, reboot. But he knows I am so stressed that the words are like trying so hard to not come out of my mouth, and I'm like twitching, right? Because I just need to start talking. And he's able to make that sacrifice and be like, okay, look, she needs to get her words out. I'll listen. I'll talk. You talk. See, those differences can be an opportunity for us to really love, in the true sense of the word, right, with charity, the other person. If we understand that they exist in the first place, and if we understand that they're good, and they are. God made us that way, they are good. Even if they can sometimes be difficult to navigate. Along those lines, are how men and women tend to bond or feel fulfilled in friendship. Women, generally speaking, need eye contact. You see, but we just don't need eye contact. We need to scrutinize your face. We are going to stare at your face. We're going to make eye contact with you. And then we are going to analyze every twitch, every blink, every half smile. Did he just smirk? What did that smirk mean? I think his eyebrow moved. I think that's affirming. I think I'm going to keep talking. That looks like a smirk. Again, I think I'm doing okay. What does that, he just looked away from me. Am I already boring him? Now he's looking totally, he's looking at his phone. Now he hates my guts, right? We analyze faces. Men, on the whole, on the bell curve, right? Generally speaking, men prefer to bond or feel connected side by side, not directly across, and certainly not with prolonged, intense eye contact. That can actually raise the cortisol levels. Right, he's shaking his head. That's why he really has a beard, it's so I can't scrutinize half his face.
No.
So how does that work when, you know, men are having a good time together, when they're establishing friendships? Usually involves shared experience, usually involves a lot of side-by-side. It's why he can go out with friends and sit at a table next to them, maybe say a few words, maybe have a good conversation, maybe make eye contact a total of 5 times, and then they both go quiet. And he comes home and it's like, yeah, that was awesome, we had such a good time. We barely looked at each other. It's why I can go out with a friend and if we sat side by side, I would think she hated me. We have to sit across from each other. We have to see our faces. We have to stare at each other's faces. And we have to watch our facial expressions the whole time. That's how we bond. Well, how does this play out as you start to enter into relationships? As you start to discern your vocation? As you prepare for marriage in the future? Well, maybe there's something really important that you're going to have to talk about. Maybe there's a conflict you have to resolve. What's that going to look like? When you both need to have your needs met, you both need to feel bonded, connected, understood. Maybe it looks like going for a walk, so you can look at each other, but so you can also be side by side. Maybe it looks like going for a drive in the car. Again, you're side by side, you can look at each other, I can scrutinize his face all I want, but if he's driving, he's not watching me do it. Here we are again, where these differences exist. Now we know they exist. Now we know that they're good. Now we know how we can use them to be a friend to another person. Later on down the road, maybe use them to strengthen marriage instead of it be a point of contention.
Why don't you ever let me look at you when I need to feel bonded? Why can't I sit across from you for 3 hours and stare at your face? Don't you love me anymore?
Right?
It avoids that.
See? These differences are good. They're part of who we are. You know, along those lines, it took me about a couple years after we were married before I actually accepted that men can shut off their brains. I didn't know that was a thing. My brain doesn't shut off, ever. I remember one year I was giving this talk and I was explaining how, you know, women's brains tend to always be on. There's always something going on in the background. There's always information that's being yeeted across that corpus callosum. There's always hormones doing something that our brains don't shut off. And there was one gentleman who was sitting in the front row and in all seriousness looked at me and went, "But Mrs. Ricketts, don't you get a headache?" I was like, "Well, sometimes." Right? So imagine we just had a date, a real date, not a shower curtain date, okay? So we go on a real date, super romantic evening, such a lovely time. I'm all up in my head and all up in my feelings, like we're so much in love and I just love him so much, and I bet he's feeling the exact same way right now, and I'm playing over the whole entire evening in my head. And so he's quiet, you know, he's kind of staring off, and I'm like, he's thinking the same things I am. And so I look over at him very lovingly and I say, what are you thinking? And he goes, nothing. And right then and there, I was like, that's it. My marriage lasted about a year and a half and now we're getting divorced. He doesn't love me anymore. Maybe he's thinking about sports. Maybe, how can he not, why doesn't he want to tell me, right? Well, no, he actually just wasn't thinking about anything. And that's a thing. And it's still good. It's not something we'll ever be able to understand. Again, that's okay. Because we're different. Men and women are different. And if there's one takeaway from everything we've talked about, it's that we can't help those differences. They are part of interiorly, intrinsically, who we are and how we are created. And they're good. And that in those differences, God is revealing something to us about how complex he is, how amazing he is. And the more we accept who we are as men and as women, the more he's going to reveal himself to us. And as he does that, we are then able to reveal something about him to the world. And that's where I'm going to leave off. And I think I've got like 5 or 6 minutes for questions or feedback, if you've got any. This is your chance, guys. I'm like an open book. Yeah?
I guess I get that lots of these differences are like biological or psychological, but then to what extent, and like, yes, we should accept that, but then to what extent, if we're in a relationship, or when we're trying to talk with a person of the opposite sex or something, to what extent should we try to approach them on their terms and communicate in a way that's okay?
That's a good question. There is, there's a phrase John Paul II uses when he talks about particularly the interpersonal relationships between men and women. He uses reciprocity a lot. And I think that's a good word to sort of answer what you're asking. When we give of ourselves in any situation, when we're communicating with someone, whether it's friendship, whether it's in a relationship, whether it's in marriage, we are giving, this self-giving, it's another JP2 buzzword, right? If we are kind of denying ourselves a little bit, like in this situation where, you know, Chris wants to power down, but he knows I need to talk. In that moment, he's making a sacrifice. He's saying, I'm recognizing that she has a need. It's not super comfortable for me at the moment, but I'm going to approach her on the terms she needs me to, right? And he does that. Well, now I know my needs are being met. I feel loved, I feel seen, I feel known, I feel understood, I feel safe to be vulnerable. I, in turn, am going to look at him and say, oh my gosh, look at how much he loves me. Look how safe I feel in this intercommunication that we're having. I think I've said my words, he needs to power down his brain and I need to shut up for a minute and let him do that because I love him, right? So now it's reciprocal. Now his needs are being met. Now he feels understood. He feels seen. He feels known. He feels loved. And as we do this, me trying to meet his needs and him trying to meet my needs, guess what? We're both giving of ourselves, but both of our needs are being met. And so I know that's sort of an ambiguous answer, but that's what happens. That's the big picture. In the moment, sometimes it comes down to that self-denial, the, hey, she needs to be loved. This is the need that she needs met right now. I am going to suck it up and sacrifice so I can meet that need for her. Yeah.
So obviously, you're talking about how all these are good, but obviously, like anything, you're taking the extreme, you really bad. So could you talk a little bit about how you can kind of restrain those parts of like, make sure you don't go to the extreme and with your
So that's another really good question, and it speaks to you like to talk about the mean, you know, in the middle, and that was Augustine. No, Aristotle. Aristotle was one of the A's. Aristotle. So right, that's how Aristotle defined virtue. It's the middle of two extremes. A good check for ourselves is always to make sure we're not using how we're created as men and women as an excuse. When we start using it as an excuse, or when we start excusing bad behavior or destructive behavior in someone else, that's when we know we've gone too far in either direction. Is that kind of answer your question without me giving a whole other talk? Right? So if you find yourself saying, you know, like, well, I can sit here for 5 hours and scroll mindlessly through Amazon and stare at the wall and shirk all my responsibilities because I'm a guy and I need to power down my brain, right? Well, now you're using it as an excuse. Now you're probably not walking that middle path, but where the virtue is found. Likewise, as women, if we have literally been talking at our friend or our significant other who is a guy for 6 hours straight, and we haven't let him get a word in edgewise, and while we're talking at him, we are dragging him around the mall, gathering things, and he looks like his head's about to explode. Well, we can't just say, well, but I'm a girl, and I need to do this, and, you know, if he loves me, he'll follow me around for 6 hours and let me talk at him nonstop. Well, here we are again, right, excusing our behavior, using our femininity as an excuse rather than as something that rather that reciprocal relationship that we talked about before. More questions? Going once, going twice. Look at that, I'm like 2 minutes early. All right, thanks guys.
Thank you.